Okay, thank you. Hi everybody again. And in the first lecture I stopped it in the middle, or I thought that it's in the middle. I realized that I have only one slide left from the first lecture, so let's have that. And then we go actually to the second one. So I stopped here where I have introduced this thing that one has to be careful about the orbital positions and so on, but there are formulas which take care of them very nicely. Namely the concept of minimal quantum metric, which you have automatically when orbitals are at high symmetry position. Now, what I have shown you so far were mostly results derived in some kind of limits. I think it's very useful to get some intuition and basics from results that are for specific cases. However, these things are more general. So in our papers and in other people's papers, you can find a formula for the non-isolated band. That one I actually showed you already. But also for a non-time reversal symmetric case, there are some results, both some analytical and numerical, but they are quite cumbersome formulas. Now, with these corrections that I showed, these things that you have to take into account, the dependence of the order parameter on the vector potential, this orbital position thing, that becomes really tricky if you don't have time reversal symmetry. In the sense that, well, if you look at superconductivity literature, and maybe there's now some wise people here who can advise me, but it's not always very clear what is the definition of the superfluid weight. That should you calculate the derivative of the free energy or the ground potential. And these are, of course, related by just by adding or subtracting chemical potential times particle number. And if you have a time reversal symmetry, then actually it doesn't matter which one you use, because time reversal symmetry means that this thing is valid. So when you apply this, you will see that these are actually equivalent. Mm-hmm. Now,
what is mu?
The chemical potential.
Okay.
Yeah.
What is U inside the chemical potential?
That's the vector potential that I applied, or Cooper pair momentum, if you wish. So the superfluid weight is defined in this way that if you introduce a Cooper pair momentum, so your order parameter is like delta times e to I q r, q times r. So you have a spatially a varying phase of your order parameter. This means that you have supercurrent. So when you plug into your Hamiltonian and everything, that kind of Cooper pair momentum, how much does the energy change? So you calculate the change of the free energy or of the ground potential. And in the time reversal symmetric case, these two give exactly the same result. Now, if your system is not time reversal symmetric, then you should choose which one. And yeah, and then with these corrections that I showed, that you should self-consistently evaluate the order parameter with finite Q and calculate the derivative. Now the same will apply then to your chemical potential. And the question is, yeah, should you take this into account or not? Yeah.
So if you don't have time reversal inversion, except generically the minimum of the free energy is actually not in Q equals zero. So you might have the ground state wants to have a twist.
Yeah. That's true. Yes. So, but that would be another thing. That's like a property of the ground state. So first you should calculate your ground state. It might have finite Q. But this is like the applied vector potential. Then you calculate the response. Yeah. Anyway, so it becomes a cumbersome thing. And I don't have the final solution. We have tried to see the literature which one is more kind of the more fundamental derivation, and it also depends how do you what do you think your chemical potential is, Because if you think that it's some kind of external, let's say, gate potential that fixes your density somehow, that gate, then that's constant. It should not depend on change if you put supercurrent. On the other hand, if you think that it's just a Lagrange multiplier in your calculation, then you should somehow self-consistently evaluate it to finite cube. So there are open questions if you're interested to work on it, and if you have opinions, you please feel free to tell me. All right, so now if you want to kind of start work on these things or understand them better, so this is the first paper, so this is, well, yeah, you should read that one as well, but that's maybe if you want to cite the original paper, that's it. And then this I would recommend as the easiest access to the topic, because it's a review and a kind of short format review. And then to really calculate things, I think these two articles are good because they have up-to-date formulas with this basis independence correctly implemented. And just as one side remark still, I want to say that these basis independent formulas, you can get it also via other route that what we use, namely calculating the superfluid weight with RPA included. So because RPA kind of goes one step forward in taking self-consistently the changes of the order parameter and so on into account when you apply a perturbation. Good, so any questions about the first lecture now, because I changed to the second one? Right. So actually, the second lecture is a bit more than the title promises. I could not fit everything in the title. So you see, we start with whether this can be relevant for twisted bilayer graphene. Then I go to tell a little bit about normal state. In this kind of systems where you have flat band superconductivity, the normal state is usually very interesting. Tell a bit about that. Then I go to non-equilibrium transport. We have talked about supercurrent, which is actually a property of the ground state for superconductors, but now what if you apply finite voltage and go to non-equilibrium? There are very interesting things happening there. And then a bit deviation away from superconductivity. I just discuss DC conductivity in flat band briefly. And in the end, we learned something about the many-body quantum metric and where that could be useful. So far, the quantum metric that I have discussed is always the single particle one or non-interacting one. Nevertheless, as you have seen, it's meaningful for many-body phenomena like superconductivity. So let's start with TBG. I think this does not require any introduction here, but well, let's repeat again. If you take the graphene sheets, you twist them with some magic angle, you get flat bands, and around this condition, then depending on the filling, you have some interesting correlated states, insulators, and so on, and also superconducting domes. This picture is from our review article. I refer to this if you want to know more about how these things are relevant for TBG. And so immediately when this MIT experiments were there, of course I thought that we should see whether our quantum geometry contribution is relevant. So we started to work on it. And okay, this is another introductory slide. I don't think it needs discussion here. So, but we were not the only groups that immediately thought that maybe this quantum geometry matters. So there were three simultaneous publications by Enrico Rossi's group and Andre Bernevik's group, and they were highlighted in this. This is also nice reading by Laura Klassen. So I tell a little bit about what we said. The message in these three papers is quite similar, but there are some differences in the approach. So, yeah, many people at that point were doing, for instance, things with this Bitziger McDonald model or BM model. We thought that because in this quantum geometric contributions, the other bands are important. So we didn't want to restrict immediately some kind of very small number of bands effective model. So here, the completely non-interacting bands, you can of course calculate easily. So here you see how you have some large twist angle, we have some number of modes, and then you twist more close to the magic angle. So here at the magic angle, you can have something like 12,000 bands because you have 12,000 sites in a unit cell. So that's too much even to do mean field theory, if you want to do mean field BCS, for instance. So, but we wanted to have a lot of bands. So we used so-called renormalization Moir trick, where you do some rescaling and you get kind of a larger twist angle, but you keep the same Moir permittivity and the Dirac velocity invariant. So we ended with something like 600 bands, and with that we did mean. And then the pairing mechanism was not known and is still not completely known. So we did two kind of different approaches. The S-way local interaction, this kind of Hamiltonian. All my previous lecture was about this kind of on-site interaction. However, here we also considered like RVP type pairing, where you have like repulsive interaction. Get out of that attractive one. There were many lectures also already about that, how you could get an attractive one, and we calculated both of them. So this, you see this what I have shown, this quantum at the general level is not really restricted to this type of interaction. Only that the neat analytical formulas that I get have been derived for this. I tried this. And yeah, okay, at this point I have to say this kind of disclaimer that the TBD theory develops extremely quickly. So we were using the understanding that was available, let's say 2019, about it. So I think all this should be revisited in the quantitative sense. But I think this still will deliver two points. I will tell you what the points are in a few slides. All right, so with this disclaimer, I present here also some numbers. So we calculated the superfluid weight in the way that I have told you, including the geometric contribution. And then we use this well-known formula to get the peak eddy temperature. And here you see it. So again, we also varied the interaction because it's not known what is the value of the interaction in this effective interaction of these materials. So this actually is the value of it's actually maximum of our mean field gap, but it's basically related. So with RVB interaction, yeah, we get this kind of BKT temperature with the local one. So the numbers are reasonable, few kelvins. And then here we try to see whether this relation that is very typical for flat bands, namely that the critical temperature scales with the interaction, whether that's valid. So if it's up like a perfectly valid, these should be straight lines. So they are a bit, but not completely. So of course, BKT, sorry, TBG is not a perfect flat band. There is some dispersion. So we are supposed to see a mixture of flat band effects and dispersion. Good. And then as a function of filling, for a kind of smaller interaction, we see maximum of the big AT temperature exactly at the points where the superconductors are observed. But if we put a very big interaction, then there is no structure. Then we looked also at what type of order parameters one gets. In the local theory, yes? Yeah, so I remind you that this quantum metric of a band, it kind of carries information about all the other bands as well. So indeed, for my calculation, if I want to calculate pairing here and so, I could do it with four bands if I am 100% sure that the quantum geometric properties of those bands only are the same as in the full model.
The quantum geometric tensor is only defined using the projector to the band. Technically, I just need a projector to the band.
Yes, 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 that's right. So, but you see this result where where superfluid weight is proportional to quantum metric, this is a kind of result for certain limit. So for instance, that you have isolated flat band. So it's not completely correct result. So I cannot use that. I want to do everything numerically with the full formulas. So therefore, to have the contribution of the higher bands accurately, I need them in my calculation. I will show you soon like how many. We didn't actually need all the 600. We don't know from the beginning how many you actually need. Okay, good point. Yeah, but first about the shape of the order parameter. So in the local pairing S-wave case, we got a very usual isotropic a superfluid weight, but in this non-local pairing, we got a non-isotropic response, meaning that in the so this is the superfluid weight tensor. So this one is for the local pairing, but in the RVP case, you see that this are slightly different. So this is not exactly zero, this one. Oh, I mean, it's close to zero, but these two deviate a bit. So we get a nematic phase there. And when we look at the pairing symmetry, it's some kind of mixture of S. I don't think so. Yeah. But maybe. Anyway, so then let's go to the main point. We wanted to analyze how much in this superfluid weight is this geometric contribution and how much the conventional. We can do it because behind this plot there is a CDG theory for the 600 bands and really pinpoint which is geometric, which are those interband processes and which is in intraband. So for the RVB, it's here, and for the S-wave local interaction here. So the pink one is what you would get from the conventional contribution only. So this comes from the fact that there is some dispersion in TPT. But the blue one is the geometric contribution. So depending on what your interaction actually is, we think that it might be somewhere here. This contribution, this geometric one, can be sizable. So you would probably make some quantitative mistakes if you don't take it into account. And now let's come to the question, like, why do we need so many bands? So if we have only the four bands, we calculate, take into account in our superfluid weight only four bands, then we get this one. And then eight bands like this. And this is the full result. And we, if I remember correctly, we needed something like 16 bands, or was it 20 or something, to get the converts. It was not needed, but we really needed more than just the four bands.
So can you actually anticipate the result by looking at the off-diagonal matrix element of the current object on a band basis?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, this would be the quick way to check, like, how big they are and so on, because they are indeed the things that we are keeping or not keeping. Of course, the superfluid weight is a very complicated, combination of them, so they might cancel. But at least those that are immediately zero already, you can neglect. Sorry?
Are all the 16 bands like right at the triangle part? Like,
probably.
Right in the vicinity of the
bottom, or no? Yeah, it could be that this looks reasonable, that it would be like this area. Yeah, which would make sense to me that it's really important to have all these. Also with the more recent understanding, like this Bernevich's heavy light fermion stuff and so on. So you really, these are very important for the transport properties to come up also here. Yes. And then I emphasize that since this time of the publication, there have been a lot of advancements in TPT theory by Oskar Pafek, for instance, a very good microscopic theory about how the strain effects and so on. So I believe that if one wants to fluid weight for TPG, one should start from the modern description of the system and calculate the numbers, and they might be different. But I think I have two key points here. One is this, that the geometric contribution might be, I think it's probably quite sizable. So when calculating superfluid weight, you have to take it into account. You cannot just use some And the second thing is that if you go to some kind of effective models where you have only, you really have to worry about taking the quantum geometric. Even if you know the quantum metric for these bands perfectly, that might not be quantum metric result is for an idealized case. So you really have to calculate numerically, and then you you should think about it like this game. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you can which are interband processes and what which are intraband, so you can really separate these two.
Which component of the
is probably determinant. Yeah. It doesn't matter because you can make some kind of rotation. We usually often take the determinant and the square to signify the size overall. Okay, so people got also interested in looking at this. So there is by far, so far, one experiment where they specifically wanted to look at this. But they don't measure superconductivity directly. They measure the critical field and the critical current, and then they use these known kind of BCS formulas to relate that to superfluid weight. So then they plot the superfluid weight, which has been kind of obtained from this critical field and current. It looks like this as function of density. And then if they plot here, right description, and then they have a kind of just a dimensional analysis basically, or something like this, that how does it scale with delta, and this is an arbitrary constant, and that one gives a bit better, and then they think that okay, also in the but it's actually calculating properly from the microscopic starting point. So that's very exciting. Let's see what happens. All right. So then I go to the normal state. Ladder, which is like a 1D system where you can have flat bands, and then we put it like as a ring and a flux through, so like a Harrow bomb effect. And now and here you see for the flat band and the non-flat band how the energy behaves as a function of this flux. And it's quite different qualitatively. Namely, in the flat band, it's pi periodic, while in the non-flat band, it's 2 pi periodic. So this means that in the flat band, you have the charge carriers have charge 2. And this is a result that is just about the ground state at any temperature. So this is not a superfluid necessary. This is also in the normal state. So in this system, only thing that can move one state. And in this nice geometry of Kreutz ladder, we were able to non Fermi liquid normal state study. Now we looked at the Lib lattice with attractive interactions and a bit more detailed, let's say, calculating more correlators and so on. So this is again to the attractive Hubbard model with just on-site interactions. So this should be negative. And we use this unit cell of the Lib lattice is now cluster. We are clustered, can be just one atom. We used here like one. You get, for instance, the green functions and self energy of impurity in the cluster, and you get self energy there. You plug it into the whole lattice green function, and you get from there. You get a new guess for the result. So exactly locally. And self energy is frequency dependent. That's by the name dynamical. So then we wanted to look at things like pseudo gap in the normal state, and for that you need to solve the four operator correlator, like this one, because the generalized field susceptibility is defined by this. Spin susceptibility scaled by interaction. For small interactions, it really goes down at zero temperature. While for B is the and small interactions and flat band, even a bit bigger interaction, it goes down. But in the flat band, it doesn't go. transport calculations, which is true. I think you should get them, but it's hard to get them directly from. Anyway.
In one dimension, we have Latin Deluxe, which was exactly the same behavior. That
yeah.
The z goes to zero, but it's metallic.
Yeah.
So I guess I agree with the referee that having a divergent or vanishing z does not indicate.
Yeah.
Just
that's true. Yeah. So in this sense, it's really important to study transport. So I think the title of our paper is something like insulator-like behavior or something. Yeah.
Without having to do a metric situation, is to calculate the compressibility. Then that would tell you if it's an insulator or not.
Ah. Okay, yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Actually, we should
calculate.
And does that conclude? Yes, calculate that because we calculate the superfluid stiff boundary condition.
Same thing.
Okay, good. Thanks. I get a lot of ideas. Yeah. Point is that the normal state in these flat bands can be very interesting, and new type of things can happen. Good. So let's go to transport. So as I mentioned, supercurrent is actually a ground state property, meaning you can have supercurrent, no voltage difference, and so on. But of course, people do all the time experiments and devices and so on by imposing a voltage difference in your over your superconductor, and this is then a non-equilibrium problem. So there is a small news article about this if you quickly want to know what is in our paper. So we went to the non-equilibrium. Then I thought many years ago that this is a direction where one must go. And we started again with a toy model system. So some kind of lattice which can have flat bands and two leads. And now a voltage difference is possible. And we can put the leads to be normal and superconducting and whatever. So the usual kind of thing. And the middle part is the sawtooth lattice or ladder. Which when it's infinite, it nicely has one flat band and one dispersive band. So in the same system, we can now probe flat and dispersive bands. Of course, we have a finite system, so there you don't have bands, but you have states that very much resemble the band behavior. Namely, you have this kind of what we call flat band states, so these are localized by interference. So they have a lot of amplitude here with plus and minus, and then it's just if you put particle in this state, it doesn't go anywhere. There are also edge states because this is finite, and these are also kind of immobile. And then there are dispersive states, so here you can put and we in our and everything is time dependent. then we solve the problem using the Keldysh formalism. So the thing with non-equilibrium Green's function is the Dyson equation, and then we also need the current kinetic equation, and there we get Green's functions as function of omega, which is very convenient because we can, when we put omega to zero, that's the DC current. And if we have a voltage, you know that AC Josephson effect, for instance, goes with the omega equals 2 times the voltage. So we can pick up that component as well. So here now we put a voltage difference between the leads, and we look at the current at some point here, and the everything here is calculated. Then the order parameters of the leads are fixed, but then what happens in the middle? The of gate voltage, we have the dispersive states, and here is the flat band. So you see that the DC current, it just goes through the dispersive band. It's very small. And then the AC. Interacting, non-interacting, again in the dispersive case, it just goes through. However, in the flat band, the only thing that you have is the AC component in presence of interactions. I mean, we know the interacting case in equilibrium, flat band is an insulator for single particles. But now we have interactions and we have non-equilibrium. The DC current here, when there are interactions. So now when there are interactions, it's a superfluid. In when you have a voltage, this in usual source, this kind of chunks. So you have a pair approaching, and then superconductors, and it's a coherent process, but quasi-particles. So it seems that this that's how our data looks like. Okay, then we also did here, it was the SS junction, the combinations NN, with and without interactions, there is nothing in the flat band. So nothing in the case when one of them, while everything goes through the dispersive bands, as is in is usual. So here I have a point now. You know, people have been interested in flat bands because interactions dominate over kinetic energy, so you might get high TC, or you may get all kind of correlated states and so on. But here is a point. Also, the transport could be quite different. They would like to play with the supercurrent, but they are there, they move and so on. So who knows maybe flat bands can change this scenario. Maybe the quasi-particles really are kind of trapped or localized, even in non-equilibrium. That's what our study hints. Okay, but our study is, of course, done for a particular flat band model, and there's much more to investigate. Good. In any system, you start by the semi-classical Boltzmann. But if you're interested in flat bands, you immediately get disappointed. Oof, here I have derivative of the dispersion, so no current. Yeah. But then there is the Kubo-Greenfold formula, which is kind of more advanced. And here, again, the current should be there. And you have those here like this. So, and these things will lead to some very curvatures, quantum metrics, and so on. So, somebody who knows about quantum geometry gets like, haha, there might be a quantum geometric contribution of DC conductivity. So these people actually predicted that there would be. The DC conductivity in flat band is proportional to a quantum metric. But me and Kukka, no, this cannot be. And now tell me why we thought that it cannot be true. Again, kind of based on my last lecture. No, this is about the normal state. This is not superconductor.
Oh.
Yeah. But there was something related to this. You remember I had this example of Lieb lattice in the when I discussed this basis dependence. So, yeah. So there I showed this case that. In the Lieb lattice, you can make the unit cells disconnected. So it just disconnects the sites. And then, of course, you cannot have any kind of conductivity, super or normal or whatever. But you still have finite quantum metric. So remember this. You can have, also in SSH model, you can take the disconnected sites limit. And you still have finite quantum metric because something is happening in the unit cell. So quantum metric. So we thought that no, this cannot be true because you can immediately have these counter examples of, let's say, SS connections. So we started to dig into it. And in addition to Kubo-Greenwood formula, there is another formula that people usually use, often use, the Streda formula. And if you use this one, so that you first take zero temperature and then take the limit of eta goes to zero. So eta here in this transport calculation, small scattering that you have in your band, like small impurities and so on. You always need this to derive conductivity formulas. And this result is not correct. And the reason is quite subtle. So now, if you have flat bands that are perfectly flat, somewhere, but doesn't need to be everywhere. Just some part that is flat, and then you take temperature to zero, and then this thing, you get a proportional quantum metric. But there are actually not only one eta, but two etas here. That by those limits in different orders, you can get any result. So the formula is not well defined. In this case, and this is why it has not been why it comes up only with flat bands is that there is always this kind of ill-defined thing in the strata formula. But if you have a Fermi surface, I mean dispersive system, it only happens in the Fermi surface. And then the whole formula is an integral over all energy. So the Fermi surface is only like a weight zero in your integral. So it doesn't matter. But as soon as you have a finite part, you have a finite contribution to the integral from the integral. However, the Cooper-Greenfield formula is fine. And here you see how they give different results. This also ladder, this has flat band and dispersive here drawn a bit differently, where we can compare. So in the flat band, and now eta was the scattering, you see, the strata formula, it indeed goes to some kind of constant at zero temperature, and this would be proportional to quantum, that's wrong. While the Cooper-Greenfield formula behaves nicely, there at zero temperature, you go to zero DC conductivity as your intuition would tell. There is still something finite here depending on your scattering. And actually this is this eta times quantum metric, so it appears there. But we can explain what it is. It is such that if you have a band gap here, there is a certain frequency where you get resonance to the other band. And then you, of course, get you go, let's say, from the flat band to this person, and then you get conductivity. So at some frequency, you have finite conductivity, and from there, you have then a Lorentzian coming to zero. Do that, but you essentially get this that when your flatness goes to zero, you get zero. Well, okay. I really doubt that you would get this result. I would think that it goes down, but it goes somehow. Yeah, but the thing, the contribution that comes from the small dispersion is kind of trivial. So I don't think that you would increase the quantum metric contribution, but you would have some dispersion contribution. Yeah, so you have to be careful about order of. Yes, that you now have some kind of like finite amount of momenta that you take into account in the flat band. Right, so I think I will use a couple of minutes to the last point. So first of all, I think it's really great that the single particle quantum metric tells us something about a correlated system, because you can calculate it, yeah. But it's also interesting to think whether we can learn something from the many-body quantum metric. And you can define it exactly the same way as the single particle one. Now your psi zero is a many body quantum state of a complicated many problem, and you have somehow miraculously solved it, and it's there. And then you can introduce, for instance, a twisted boundary condition, and so on, and calculate derivative to the twist. So this is. So then we have kinetic Hamiltonian, maybe some on-site potential Hamiltonian, and some interaction. No, not specifying the interaction at all. Then we introduce this twisted boundary condition by putting in a phase that is increasing every hopping. And meaning that when we close the system with a periodic boundary condition, we actually have a flux through. And then we calculate the through the wave, which is defined like this in a many body system. You can define it as a kind of a susceptibility to a change of energy when you put this flux in. To a second order, so you will have the kinetic part phi squared and then the current operator phi. And then to perturbation theory with respect to this thing, the through the weight becomes the expectation value of the kinetic energy in your system. This is very natural. You would have movement if this expectation.
But there is another contribution, looks like this.
By using, you see, this one, we can show that this is lower bounded by the many body quantum metric times the band gap. Again, in a system where you have a band gap to the next band. So then you see that the many body quantum metric. Supercurrent or same in cap. Here it puts it down. But the physics is completely different. In the single particle quantum metric, the meaning of that was that it tells about overlap of one-year functions. And here it's really how much your state changes when you put a little bit of flux. So kind of sensitivity of your state to little current. And if it's very sensitive, it's maybe natural to think that the through the weight goes down. Okay, so now I'm in the end. I'm hiring postdocs. So if you're interested in these things, you have to contact me very quickly because I have already made some offers, but maybe some people can know. So on. And this is in a big project where we have a very interesting collaborators. And then there is another opportunity. Tero Heikkilä, who is one of these people in our consortium, is searching for postdocs as well, and they are in collab. Then their projects are in collaboration with me. And there it's maybe not so much in Rust. He just started this. Okay, so these were the topics and the message, take-home message. Quantum geometry is relevant to any transport or interaction phenomena where are important. And this is like a new viewpoint to condensed matter physics, like you are using the band structure and looking at it and making guesses based on that. Now learn to plot or visualize or geometry of your bands, and you can guess many things based on that, and push up the TC a little bit. Thank you. So you're saying whether this is a
legitimate?
Yeah, in my opinion, not. But that's what other people had done. So we wanted to make the point that if you do that, yeah. But there was a, I mean, it happened that in